What is data orientation? By the end of this episode, you will have a better idea of what we mean in functional programming when we talk about data orientation. It's a very common idea in functional languages. Hi, my name is Eric Normand, and I help people thrive with functional programming. So, data orientation, really quickly, it's just programming with data. But, you know, let's go a little deeper than that. So what is data? Got to start with the basics. You know, you look it up in the dictionary and it says it's facts about events. So something happens, an event, and now you have some facts about it. Maybe you measured the temperature, right? So that's a fact about the event of measuring. This is what the thermometer told me. It's 80 degrees. They're facts about events. I mean, that's a very clear definition. So when we're doing data orientation, we're programming with data, a lot of our code becomes data transformation. So we're getting data from one source and we're processing it, we're storing it, we're transmitting it, we're doing something with this data. Okay, and that's one of the reasons why I like data orientation is we're making information systems usually. That's you know, especially on the back end, we're taking in information, we're taking in HTTP requests, we're taking in transactions or some other API calls, or we're reading sensors, we're doing something. We're taking in information and we're doing something with it. And data orientation is basically just saying, let's just leave it as data. Came in as data, it's going to go out as data. Let's just treat it like data the whole way through. Now, data has some interesting properties that make it good for this. One is that it has structure. We have, computer scientists that is, we have found different structures of data that are both efficient to store, you know, in memory and use, and also ergonomic. We've come up with algorithms that use them, and they are convenient for the programmer. Talking things like arrays and hash maps, numbers, strings, all these things that we're used to. These are just data. And so you can build structure, you know, you can rely on the structure of those things. Data comes in, it's got certain attributes. Those attributes might have a name and a value. It becomes natural to think maybe this would be a good candidate to use a hash map for, because I'm going to be looking up these values by the attribute name. So that's the structure part. Sort of a plus and a minus, it's a double-edged sword, is that data requires interpretation. It's not meaningful by itself. If I said the number 5, you have no idea what that means. Even if I put a unit on it, 5 pounds, you still don't know what it means. It requires context before it can be used. And that context might be embedded in the data. It might be from the software or the, you know, the interpreter's perspective. It really requires interpretation. Like, you have to have a purpose. Why am I reading this? What can I learn from it? What decisions can I make from it? And all of that stuff means that without those things, the data doesn't have any meaning by itself. Just as an example, I know this is kind of silly, but like I look at data as like a really old tradition. Like, it goes back to the earliest record keepings that we have, like before the invention of writing, you know, you could mark the number of cattle that you were, you know, trading with someone on a stone tablet or something, or a clay tablet, and you're counting, right? And you're keeping records. Like, each little mark is a fact about an event. A cow passed through this gate, you know? So you're just marking that, and then you have this aggregate data. Now, they're just marks on a clay tablet, but if you know how to interpret it, you can glean a lot from it. So then the clay tablet gets buried somewhere. 4,000 years later, an archaeologist finds it, and now they have to interpret it. Now, they might figure out from context, oh, this was counting cattle, right? And so they're not just worried. Like, what the person who originally made this thing was concerned with was, like, getting a fair deal. You know, they want to make sure that everyone's getting paid the right amount of money. Like, that's their concern, right? But now this archaeologist can interpret the same marks in a totally different way. The archaeologist can now say, oh, well, like, let's learn about the economy of this civilization. Oh, look, this year was a really good year. Look how many cattle came through here. Now, this year is really bad because it had a, you know, fewer number. They must have been hungry at that time. And then that might explain why they went to war, or, you know, whatever they can glean from it. That is now a different purpose from the same data. That's what I mean when data requires interpretation. That's kind of like, it's meaningless by itself, but on the plus side, it can be interpreted in multiple ways. It's kind of neutral. You're just writing down the temperature, and, like, you know, what do you do with that? Well, that is up to you. All right, so at this point, you know, I said data orientation is something I like, because we're writing information systems. We're taking in data, we're writing it out again, we're storing it, we're transforming and processing it, generating new data from that original data. And so it seems like, well, isn't that what programming is? And I would say yes, except there are some styles of programming, some paradigms, you might say, where things like data hiding are more prominent, are like important parts of that paradigm. Like in object-oriented programming, you might say we want to hide this data behind an interface. Okay, we want to hide the pieces of information, the facts that we have, and you're going to have to call methods or send me messages. And I will do the interpreting for you. That's basically what object orientation is saying. I will do the interpretation for you because data requires interpretation, and so I will be your interpreter. Sometimes that's nice because that interface lets you do polymorphism and stuff like that. Different things have different data, but they can still have the same interface. That's really nice. But that's not data orientation. I'm trying to juxtapose the two. When you remove that hiding, so if you have hiding, you're adding a layer of interpretation on your data that is required. You have to go through this interpreter layer to read the data. It makes it much harder to interpret the data in multiple ways. Okay. When you have the data raw, you can interpret it however you want. Okay, so that is data orientation. It's leaving it raw so that you can interpret it. Different parts of the system have different purposes. They can read it and do different things with it. If you need to hide it, then what you're doing is you're going to bake in different interpreters into that interface, and this will just make the class get bigger and bigger. because you're going to need methods that this thing needs over there. You're going to need methods that that thing needs. Or you could have some system for like having different interfaces on the same data, but then how do you get the data between them? It's really hard. So in data orientation, we just prefer to not hide, just expose it and let the interpreters, let whatever interpreters want to run on it, want to interpret it, do whatever they need to do. That is data orientation. All right, I'm going to recap. Data orientation is just programming with data, no hiding. Data is facts about events. Data-oriented programming, you tend to do a lot of data transformations. Your system is inputting, storing, transmitting, processing data. That's what it does. So everything you're doing is something, well, not everything, but like most of what you're doing is one of those things. Data has structure to it, and it needs that structure because you need some common way of understanding of using the data. So what I mean by that is like, you know, the structure of a string, right? You know, you can access each character by index, and you know the characters are going to be, you know, some kind of Unicode thing, and you can append two of them. Like, it has a structure that we understand. And then it requires interpretation. It's a double-edged sword. It requires it, but it allows different ways of interpreting the same data. Awesome. If you like this episode, I think you should subscribe, because I've got two more episodes like lined up. They're right here. Here's my notes. Two more of these ready to record, and they'll be coming right down after this one. So you should subscribe and you'll get them. If you want to, you should go to lispcast.com/podcast. You'll see links to subscribe and also to get in touch with me on social media. I love getting into discussions. A lot of these topics came out of questions that people had. Because I said something and they didn't understand it, I was being confusing. I needed to explain more. So this is what this is. I also love just getting into discussions. Maybe you disagree with me. Maybe you have a different idea of what data orientation means. On lispcast.com/podcast, you'll also find all the old podcasts, the previous podcasts, the episodes, with audio, video, and text transcripts, so you can consume it however you want. All right, this has been my thought on functional programming. I'm Eric Normand. Thanks for listening, and rock on.